Hello friends, I am NK Jain from Skill on Tech. We have already discussed a lot how a hydraulic thrust is produced in centrifugal pumps and compressors, and it is of two types. One is radial thrust, other one is axial thrust. Today I will explain you how to balance radial thrust in centrifugal pumps and compressors. What are the measures to be taken to balance this radial thrust to have a longer life of equipment, machine, rotating components such as bearings. Video become very interesting. Hence, please see the complete video. And if you like the video, please share it with your friends and colleagues. How is radial thrust defined? You can see a picture of a volute casing in this slide. As we know, in a volute casing, area of the discharge path of the casing is not similar. Hence, due to pressure variation in the discharge path, a radial thrust is produced. So, how we can define it? At the nominal operating point, the centrifugal pump impellers, a radial thrust is defined as R equal to K rho G H D into B, where R is equal to radial force, K equal to radial force coefficient, rho equal to density of the fluid handled, G equal to acceleration due to gravity, H equal to head imparted by the pump, D equal to outside diameter of the impeller, and B equal to impeller outlet width. Radial thrust minimization. Double volute casing. You can see a picture of a single volute design casing and a double volute design casing in the presentation. Here, this is a single volute design, this is a double volute design casing. In a single volute design casing, you can see there is an area variation in a discharge path of a volute casing. Therefore, the pressure is also varying in the discharge path of a single volute design casing, causing production of unbalanced radial forces. So, these unbalanced radial forces are balanced up to a certain extent by making a modification in a single volute design casing by a double volute design casing. Here you can see in a double volute design casing, the casing is split in two parts and a ring is provided in a volute casing, and area of a discharge path along the impeller is made similar, and so there is no pressure variation in the double volute design casing. Hence, the unbalanced radial forces are managed up to a certain extent, and radial thrust which are residual in double volute design casing are very small. Radial thrust minimization. Diffuser casing. You can see a picture of a diffuser casing. Here you can see this is impeller and this is a diffuser casing where nozzles have been provided, or you can say guide vanes have been provided at every stage in the discharge of impeller. In the diffuser casing, the impeller discharges into a uniform ring of nozzles, and consequently the radial loading on the impeller is fully balanced, meaning zero radial load over the full flow range. As we know, bearing failures are the second most common reason for pump failures due to the radial load unbalance. These casings also facilitate to operate pump at its best efficiency point, BEP. Diffuser casings are commonly used for vertical turbine and multi-stage high head pumps for maximum pump reliability, and where high efficiency is of major importance. Therefore, you can see where multi-stage pumps are used, generally diffuser casings are used to facilitate to run the pump at BEP. Radial thrust load management. Radial thrust load management in pumps and compressors are done by providing suitable bearings. The bearings may be of following types: anti-friction bearings such as ball, roller, etc. These ball and roller bearings are suitable for light to moderate loads. Journal bearings, sleeve type, suitable for heavy loads and used in higher capacity pumps and compressors. Design of bearing for radial load. You can see a picture of a deep groove ball bearing. These bearings are designed to take radial load in static and dynamic condition of bearing, and plane of rotation of the ball is normal to the center line of bearing. The bearings suitable for radial loads are deep groove ball bearings, angular contact ball bearings, filling notch bearings, double row ball bearings, self-aligning ball bearings. Axial and radial loads on bearings. The picture showing two loads on bearing, axial and radial load. The bearings have to face load in static and dynamic condition. In order to select most suitable bearing, first of all, basic dynamic load capacity for bearing is calculated. Then the selection of bearing with respect to bearing number is made from catalog of a bearing manufacturer. The bearing manufacturers are providing bearings with bearing number in their catalogs, and we can select a bearing according to our requirement from the catalog and then procured from a reputed manufacturer of bearing. Resultant hydraulic thrust in pumps. You can see a picture of a shaft along with bearing showing a radial thrust and a axial thrust. Here you can see this is a axial thrust. This in the direction of axis of shaft, and this is a radial force perpendicular to the axis of shaft. Bearing supports a shaft or housing to permit their free motion about an axis of rotation. Loads can be applied to bearing in either of two basic directions. So bearings are taking load on two directions. One is in radial direction, other one is in axial direction. So radial load act at a right angle to the shaft, this, and axial thrust act parallel to the axis of rotation, this. When these loads are offset from either the bearing axis distance ST, this distance, or this distance, or radial plane distance SR, a resulting moment load M will be created. So what will be that resulting moment load M? Here you can see in the equation, the resultant moment load M equation, M equal to thrust load into ST plus radial load into SR. Bearings for radial and axial thrust load. You can see a picture of a shaft supported at two bearings. A rotating machine element, for example the shaft, generally requires two bearings to support and locate it radially and axially relative to the stationary part of the machine. For example, the housing. Normally, only one of the bearing, the locating bearing. Here in this picture you can see this is the locating bearing, this bearing, and this is a non-locating bearing. The locating bearing is used to fix the position of the shaft. Here the shaft position is fixed in this bearing because this is a locating bearing. Wrist, the other bearing, the non-locating bearing is free to move axially, this bearing. So this bearing can move freely in the axial direction. So the bearing, locating bearing, which is fixed, it will take only radial load, but the other bearing, This, which is non-locating bearing, will take radial load as well as axial loads. So generally, here in the locating bearing, a deep groove ball bearing is provided or a deep groove roller bearing is provided. But in the non-locating bearing, angular contact ball bearing is provided for taking radial and axial loads. Radial and thrust deep groove ball bearings or roller bearings. Three sketches of bearing is given. The first sketch of cylindrical roller bearing shown is suitable for radial load only. Here you can see this is a cylindrical roller bearing and suitable for radial load only. Why? Because this roller is fixed and it does not have any movement in axial direction. So this roller bearing will not take any load in the axial direction. It will be only for radial load. The second sketch of deep groove ball bearing is suitable for axial thrust load as having cushion to move axially due to split in races. Here you can see this is a deep groove ball thrust bearing and suitable for axial load. You can see in the races there are split. So 1, 2, 3. So there is three races are joined together and having a split which can have a cushion in axial movement. The third sketch is for both radial and axial load. Here you can see this is a deep groove ball bearing for radial and axial load. This is likes. This is a angular contact ball bearing where it can take both the loads. And you can also see here in the inner race there is a margin for axial movement. Bush and two-piece sleeve bearings. You can see a sketch of bush provided over a shaft. Typically, bushing pressure is obtained by dividing the maximum load imposed on the bushing by the pressure supporting area of that bushing. The pressure supporting area is defined as the projected loading area which is in contact with the shaft, projected in the direction of the load in the case of a cylindrical bushing. You can see in this picture that this is a support where you can see a reaction F, because the load you can see here F by 2. So both are radial loads, and similarly you can see here this load is F and reactions at the both ends are F by 2. And here also you can see. So bushes are provided to take radial load only. These are provided over shaft, so bushes support the shaft and take radial loads only. Sleeve type journal bearing. You can see a picture of two pieces of a sleeve bearing. The bearings are called sleeve type bearing and are available in two piece. These bearings are available in Babbitt metal lining suitable to load requirement, tin or lead base, preferably used with base metal CS. These bearings are used in large size pumps and compressors to take heavy radial loads and are hydrodynamically lubricated. The other bearings in a sleeve type which are suitable for taking radial load as well as thrust load, axial loads will be discussed in upcoming video. In the upcoming video, we will discuss how to manage axial thrust in pumps and compressors. The upcoming video will become very interesting. I request you to see please the coming video. Thanks for watching the video. If you like this video, please hit like button below. Share it with your friends and colleagues. Subscribe our channel for getting updates on upcoming videos. Please leave any comments, feedback to improve the videos. Thank you.